Okay, good morning everybody. Are we starting with a slight delay due to lateness of the group of the Dutch people who are supposed to be here, but I don't see them yet. Okay, we'll get started. I'll also continue a bit longer, but in view of the length of the lunch break, I don't think that will be a problem. So let's let me try to recapitulate what I've said to you in the previous lectures. And we started with the discussion of a definition or possible definition of what we mean by randomness and probability. And that naturally leads to the idea of integrating functions using Monte Carlo, using random numbers. And if you want to do that well, you have to construct estimators. We've been discussing that. Then we have also looked at the question of how to obtain random numbers or pseudo-random numbers, actually. And we've looked at various algorithms to do that. And the rest of the lectures, and in particular yesterday, we dealt with the question of trying to improve on Monte Carlo. And you can do that in two ways. First is to try to improve the quality of the point set that you use. This is quasi-Monte Carlo, where you say, I don't care if my points are heavily correlated. I just want them to be uniformly distributed. And there's interesting mathematics involved, and you can generate quasi-random point sets. It's actually fun to do. You can plot them easily in two dimensions and look at the interesting patterns. And what I will try to do today is to consider the other side of the problem, another source of possible improvement. This was the expected value of the square of the error that you are making. But J2 is like the integral of the square of the function, J1 is the integral itself. And where in the previous lecture we've been looking at the denominator, trying to somehow improve my point set so that this n, which is a 1 over square root of n behavior of the error, that this n becomes a higher power, maybe working towards n squared or so. And okay, that being done, you can also look at the numerator. Looking at the denominator and trying to improve that, that leads to quasi-Monte Carlo. Looking at the numerator and trying to prove that, to improve that, is the subject of variance reduction. We tried to reformulate the problem in such a way that this J2 minus J1 squared somehow becomes smaller. And there are a few ways of doing that. And the most well-known strategies are a thing called stratified sampling, which I will discuss first and shortly, and then the second strategy, general strategy, could be called importance sampling. So what do I mean by stratified sampling? Pictorially, it's very simple. Suppose I want to generate a function on the unit interval. And the function looks something like this. Okay, I can do that by Monte Carlo, just throwing random points between 0 and 1. Say you throw 1,000 points, and then sum the value of the function, sum the value of the function squared, construct your estimator, and that is your result. What you can also do is decide beforehand to divide the integration interval into bins. For instance, 4 bins. And I will do the same integration, except that I will integrate separately over each bin, taking into every bin, taking in this case n over 4 points. Okay? So I make my distribution of points already a bit more uniform, as you can see. Okay? So then I do the Monte Carlo calculation inside this bin, and I calculate the square error or I can estimate or calculate the expected square error in this bin, in this bin, in this bin, in this bin, and I add these errors in quadrature, I sum the square errors, and then you can easily prove that if your bins are all equal, for instance, and they contain the same number of points, that the error will decrease, the expected error will decrease. And this is called stratified sampling. I think the name actually comes from people who do sociological surveys, where they divide population into strata, and they interview people, a fixed number of people in each stratum. Okay. But in Monte Carlo practice, it just means take your unit hypercube. Almost all integration methods take place on the unit hypercube anyway, and you divide it into bins, and then you calculate the integral per bin, you sum that, it gives you the total integral, of course, and you calculate the error in the bin, and then you hope the error will be smaller. This can work quite well, okay? You would expect that if I take more bins, for instance, I take 8 bins now, and I have n over 8 points in each bin, that would work even better. But usually it does, not always. There's a lot of trial and error going on here. I have a few remarks. Let me see if we can get to this page. Yes. So, look at the upper plot. What I did is I calculate two functions. The first function is 2 times x. And the second function was, well, this is 1 plus sine 2 pi x. These are, of course, extremely simple functions. You would not dream of needing to integrate them with Monte Carlo, but they're simple test cases. And the red dots is the integration error for the function 2x. Is I increase the number of bins from 1 bin up to 100. And you see the integration error, 10 bins. The integration error goes down. It's, of course, the line is just to guide your eye. Okay. If I function like this, the sine x plus 1, this function looks like that. And you see that if I go from 1 bin to 2 bins, then the integration error goes down. But if I settle for 3 bins, the integration error goes up again. It's always an improvement, but it's not necessarily true that more bins give you a better answer. You just have to try this out, okay? You can understand, and I already hinted at that, why this stratified sampling might work. It is almost a method of making a point set more uniform than random points. If I have 8 bins here, and I prove myself there will be 10 points in each bin, I will get a distribution of points that is more uniform than if I simply have 80 points randomly in this interval. And you can see that this is a diaphony. The lower plot shows a diaphony of the points according to the number of bins, the same number of points, but then in 1 bin or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5, and then you see the diaphony indeed goes down. So stratification is almost the same as quasification, so to speak. Okay. Now, this idea is quite simple, and it has led... Yes?
Does this method, the efficiency of this method depend on the dimension?
This is the curse of dimensionality, of course. In one dimension, it's easy to have many bins. Yeah, in high dimension...
It's similar to the regular integration, not Monte Carlo.
Yeah. But it's Monte Carlo inside each bin. It looks a bit like regular integration as well. It's an in-between form. But the fact that you use random points means that the method will work on any function that is quadratically integrable. And the other integration methods typically require much more information about your function. So, but you can understand that this kind of thing is very well suited if you are ambitious and you want to make an automatic integrator. Yes?
You said that it's better for us to have the same number of
That is one option. You don't have to do that, but...
Yes?
Yes? That is the simplest approach. And I should say, there is no law that says you need only the same number of points in each bin. It is no law that says the bins have to be equal size. The only thing is, if the bins are equal sized and they have the same number of points, then you can show that stratification is always better than no stratification. Okay? If you have different sized bins with an equal number of points, that guarantee is simply not there. And let me show you an example. This, in fact, what I was going to say. You can be ambitious, say, I will write an automatic Monte Carlo integrator where you put in any function. And let's do it on the unit hypercube. And because I have a blackboard, I will do it on the two-dimensional unit hypercube, also called a square, from 0 to 1. Of course, if you have a general function, you may need to scale your integration or transform your integration variables to make the problem fit in the unit hypercube. Okay, and what I'm now going to describe to you is one of the oldest automatic integrating programs. And since we are dealing with a subject called Monte Carlo, and since the authors of this program are Americans, they call this program called Vegas. Okay? Because you have casinos in Las Vegas as well. Okay, so what does the program do? You say, here's my function to be integrated, and I give you, this two dimensions, let's say 512 points or so, some power of 2. Then what Vegas does, he makes bins like this. Of course, in practice, many more bins than this 4x4. Okay, well, in this case, we'll give him 32 points to work with. So. And what Vegas does now is, in each bin, he throws 2 points. Even for me, you see, it is not easy to do these points really randomly. But so in each bin, there are 2 points. And I'll calculate the integral from each bin. And the error from each bin. The fact that you use 2 points per bin is an attempt to be able to maximize the number of bins. Okay. So the number of points that you use is... the number of bins is half the number of points that you use, and it can hopefully be quite large. Although in a 10-dimensional integration problem, of course, if you have only 2 bins along each axis, already have 1,024 bins. Okay, so having calculated the integral and the error per bin, of course, the Vegas reports this. They say, this is my estimate for the error, this is my estimate for the integral, and then he goes and projects the error here Vegas projects the squared error on each axis. In the columns, the sum of the errors in the columns, the sum of the errors in the rows, and of course in higher dimension analogously. And then he decides, well, okay, for instance, this second column has a suspiciously large error, larger than the other ones. Now we'll iterate my grid, and I will make the second column narrower. And maybe the fourth column has a very low error. You can afford to make it bigger because it doesn't contribute so much to the error. So after one iteration, your grid is optimized. Maybe look like this. Okay. And then you throw points again. And you keep iterating. Okay. This is actually a very stupid algorithm, but it works surprisingly well in practice. This Vegas is very old. It's from the late 1960s, but it's still being used in some applications, especially by experimental physicists. Okay, why is this stupid algorithm? Well, if we, in my opinion, at least, if I change the size of the bins also start to shift back and forth. The second bin is narrower, but there's no guarantee that it's in the same place as before. So it is quite possible that there is some peak in your function, and you try to zoom in on this peak, and your bins keep shifting back and forth without improvement. Another problem is that, of course, this is a very Cartesian structure. It only looks at the axis, looks at the rows and the columns. If your integrand has a peaking structure, that's typically what you would for, which looks like this, it's like a mountain range, but it's diagonal. There's no way of improving the bins that will actually allow you to calculate this. So you have to look at your function. You have to say, well, what are the important variables? Where is most of the fluctuation coming from? I choose those variables. So it's not like you can be blind and just plug in a function and be sure that the answer will be satisfactory. Nevertheless, people have done this, and of course, if the Americans can do it and call a program Vegas, then people at CERN can do it, and they call it after the nearest casino to Geneva. This is in Coppet on Lake Le Mans. This is in Divonne, which is the French side, is a casino. So if you want to write an automated program, then you can call it after the closest casino to your home. I had a PhD student who was postdoc in Athens, and he wrote a code. It's called Parni, because there's a casino on Mount Parnita. A Dutch student wrote code called Waalkade, because in Nijmegen, where I come from, that is a place where there is a casino. Okay. You can try to write your own integration code in this way. It's actually a good exercise. Don't do it the Vegas way, but there are other ways to try and improve your grid. But of course, if the function that you want to give to Vegas has really strong fluctuations, much better idea is to say, do a variable transformation. Okay. And that brings us to the point, to the subject of important sampling. In important sampling, we forget about uniformly distributed points. If I want to do important sampling, I look at the integral of the function that I want to calculate. This is the J1, that's the hopefully end product of the calculation. And I say, okay, I knew that I could multiply and divide by a density. Okay, so why not try to generate points not uniformly, but according to the density G? And then the thing that you have to sum to get your integral is no longer F, but it is F divided by G. This is the weight. Now suppose F has a strong peak somewhere, and I manage to find a G that has a similar peak, then the ratio F over G, the weight, typically will fluctuate less. Okay. And then you will find a much better error. That is really a decrease in the error. Important sampling is the method of choice if you can get it to work. Okay. In the ideal case, of course, maybe you would have W of X being a constant. That would be the ideal case, because then you integrate, you do your Monte Carlo integration with zero error. Okay? But what does that mean? That means here that G of X is proportional to F of X. G of X is a density. It has to be normalized. I have to know the normalization of G. Okay. So if I know the normalization of G, basically I know the integral of F. And I can calculate the weight by comparing F and G at one point, and then my problem is solved. So that's not really Monte Carlo integration. So the ideal case of important sampling is no important sampling. So typically what we see is we have an F, and in particle physics, where typically it's my job, where you have to integrate squared amplitudes for cross sections that show big peaks whenever propagators go close to the mass shell. The integrand is not negative, but it may have holes if there's experimental cuts, and there are big peaks, big sharp peaks that you have to integrate over. It is typically not possible to have G strictly proportional to F, but you can try to go as close as you can. Okay, so given F, one thing is find a function G. Of course, this is all multidimensional. I'm not even mentioning that. This works in any dimension. So I have to find an approximant to F. It's called G. And second point, generate Gx. With generating G, I mean a generated point X, points X that are random points with a probability density G of X. And they want them to be independent and identically distributed points. Okay. And then I do my standard Monte Carlo thing. I do my E1, my E2, and E4, and I get an error. Hopefully, is smaller than the one that is there, because simply I have rephrased my integration problem in terms of another one. Okay. And then you can ask yourself, okay, if I have some function g, how can I generate now points according to this distribution g? Okay. That is most of the art that goes in there. So, non-uniform random numbers. How do I go about in order to integrate or to generate random numbers according to a non-uniform but prescribed probability distribution? There are various ways. And I will discuss them shortly. There's inversion, there is rejection, there is the rule of Nifty. I'll explain that in a moment. And there are things like multi-channeling, let me also. And there is finally what I may want to discuss, random walks. So these are broad classes of strategies. So where the problem is, somebody gives you a probability density with the task for you to write code to generate random numbers according to that probability density. And almost always, we will assume that we have a source of uniform random numbers. In other words, we have a good uniform random number generator that spits out numbers between 0 and 1, uniformly distributed. And the question now is to do something to these numbers, combine them, calculate some function of these numbers, and then see what is the resulting distribution. And this is surprisingly vaguely formulated in most of the textbooks that you see, but we can say something about it using a formalism of unitary algorithms. It sounds highbrow, but it just means that an algorithm can be formulated as an integral that is equal to 1, right? This is this statement. Okay, this is a truism, because the integral is equal to 1. But I can also read it as computer code. It says here, there is an algorithm that if I call that algorithm, will give me with certainty a number with a probability density. What is this here? In fact, can write it like this. With a probability density, which is the step function between 0 and 1. Okay? This is a logical step function. It is 1 if whatever is in the bracket is true. If it's 0 if whatever is in the bracket is not true. Okay? So this statement can be interpreted as saying, hey, I have an algorithm to generate uniform random numbers between 0 and 1. Okay. Now, you could say, for instance, suppose I want to generate uniform random numbers between 0 and 2. Okay? How would I do that? Well, I will not insult your intelligence by claiming that you didn't think of this immediately. You just take your random number and multiply it by 2. Okay? But what we get then? Is this a probability density? Is this an algorithm? No, it's not. Because this evaluates to 2, not to 1. So you can say, prove or see in this case, this is of course very trivial, this is not a probability density. What is a probability density? This is a probability density. So how do I go from generating numbers between 0 and 1 to generating numbers between 0 and 2? Well, I multiply them by 2. So how shall I do that? I shall say that I take this thing. This tells me x is a random number. Typically, we can do this, but no, I won't do that. We'll call it simply x. I was trying to say, typically we call these numbers r or so to know that they're random numbers, but it's irrelevant. What I do now, this statement reads, you generate a random number uniformly between 0 and 1, and then you calculate another random number. Like this, okay? Y is 2x. So the direct delta and an extra integration variable, which you can say, okay, that's just multiplying by 1, it can be read as a computer code statement, a pseudocode statement. Yes, you say, you have x here, multiply x by 2 and call that y. And what I do now is I simply invert the direct delta, dx dy, 1 half delta x minus y over 2, times x between 0 and 1. And then, of course, if I eliminate I have dy left. Okay? Wherever this x is, I have to put y over 2. So here I have 1 half theta 0 y over 2 minus 1, which is this thing. Okay? This is extremely, extremely trivial example. But this is the general way that you can write down algorithms and analyze them, because you can get weird distribution. If you give me 7 random numbers, I can take the sine squared of the product of x1 and x2, divide by x3, multiply by the log of x4, and then take that to the power x5 plus x6 plus x7. Okay? And you get some distribution out. What is that distribution? If I simply give you the code, you cannot see what is the distribution that comes out. But if you analyze it in this way, making sure there's always a 1 on the left-hand side, you can in principle work out what is the distribution you have. And that's of course important if I want to prove that my algorithm gives me the correct density, the g of x that I want. Slightly less trivial thing here, what you also can do, for instance, is say, take y to be minus log x. In computer code, it's this, pseudocode. Say, ran is your source of random numbers, and I take y is minus log x. What is the distribution that comes out? Well, the distribution that comes out, we can do that here by saying we want to now interpret this as a delta function for x. So this is x is, what is it? E to the minus y. And log of x the derivative is 1 over x. So this is dx dy, theta 0 x 1, x times delta x minus e to the minus y, which is dy e to the minus y. So this, if you ever want to generate an exponential, this is what you do. You take a random number between 0 and 1, you take minus the logarithm. And of course, for more complicated operations, then you can work this all out. Okay. Now, let's now try to apply all this a little bit to the various strategies that we have. Okay. Let's first consider inversion. Inversion is a method of choice that if you can get away with it, you should always use it. There are many distributions that are very important that can be generated very easily using inversion. But what is inversion? It's this. So I have my function g of x. Now let's assume that I can also find the primitive function of that, which is called big G. So the big G prime is small g. And let's also assume that I can invert that function. So for a given value of big G, it is actually possible for me to find the x. Now notice this. Mathematically, this is always possible because g of x is a function that is never negative. Small g, it runs between it is integrated to 1. So big G, the derivative of big G is positive, and I know that at the endpoints of the interval that I'm looking for, big G is between 0 and 1. So that's a monotonic function that runs from 0 to 1. This equation has a solution if I put this equal to some random number. Okay. So, what is now the unitary algorithm? Say, I take my random number z between 0 and 1. So this is a code that says z comes out of a random source of numbers, and I apply g of x, delta x times g prime of x delta g of x minus z. This is multiplying by 1 in a clever enough way. And then we can see immediately that this means that x runs between x0 and x1 because z goes from between 0 and 1, and the g has these properties. It is 1 and 0 at the endpoints. And g prime of x is simply equal to g of x. So the pseudocode for this means that x is g minus 1 of z. Okay, this sounds very simple. Just one single random number turns into another random number. But of course, there are a few drawbacks. But here, this plot is maybe to help you think about it. What I've plotted there, the wavy line, is my function g. So it starts at 0, it ends at 1, okay? And what I do now, I generate the z uniformly, that is the horizontal lines. They're uniformly distributed on the z-axis, and I intersect them with the curve of g, and I project to the values on the horizontal axis. So that is calculating the inverse function of g. And then you see, and of course it intuitively clear, whenever big G is large, is steep, sorry, you will find more intersections and more axes at that place. So where small g is large, because that is the slope of big G, you find more points, and you can see that there. Okay. Now, this all sounds fair and good, but it is a bit problematic sometimes, because first of all, you may not be able to invert function big G in a simple way, okay? If there's a simple operation for big G, then it's no problem. For instance, you want this distribution. Okay, a Cauchy distribution. Then what you do is you take a random number, rho, and I take rho minus 1/2. And I take the tangent of that number, and I call it x. Okay, that's one line of code that gives me this Cauchy distribution. And another one, as I said already before, want e to the minus x, you simply take x to be minus log rho. Because we can calculate the integral and invert the integral here, for this case and for this case. Okay? And a more difficult case with also an interesting distribution is e to the minus x squared. Yeah? So, okay, what is the primitive function of e to the minus x squared? People say, yes, that's the error function. It's a well-known function. Yes, it's well-known. If you look it up, the definition of the error function is, well, it's the integral of e to the minus x squared. So can you evaluate the error function? Some languages do. Fortran, for instance, has a built-in error function. But we don't want the error function. We want the inverse of the error function. And that's a lot of hassle. You have to do that numerically. Okay. So this important distribution is not easy to see how you can generate it by inversion. Okay, anyway, this is all there is to it, except, of course, if I move to the case of more dimensions. If I have a two-dimensional, a three-dimensional, a 42-dimensional distribution, how do I do the inversion? Well, then I have to integrate. First, I have to integrate over all my variables except the first one. Okay, try to invert that, to generate that by inversion. Now, for that variable keeping fixed, I have to again to integrate over all variables except the second one. Try to find that by inversion and continue and continue. You get an enormously complicated integrals very simply. Okay, in a more dimensional case, inversion is practically impossible for any interesting distribution. But for one-dimensional distributions, well-known things like this, it's a method of choice because, for instance, it uses only one random number to get your non-uniform random number out. Okay, now what about rejection? It's another pictorial thing that is very simply explained. That is indeed the following. Say, I have a function and I want to generate between x0 and x1 points according to this distribution. What does that mean pictorially? It means that I want to construct the histogram of this function. I want to generate a million points, which if I make a histogram of the points, hey, it will be exactly this function. Of course, now this I cannot assume, let's assume I cannot do this by inversion. But I can do another function by inversion, maybe, or some other simple method that is not exactly this, but is this, for instance. So call this function p and call this function h. Now, a look at this plot tells you these things cannot be both probability densities. Because if they're probability densities, the function p is normalized to 1. And function h is always larger. Now, this is not really true. It is some constant times h. Okay? So we are not able to do the complicated curve directly, but we are able to do the relatively simpler one directly. Okay, let's do that. What we do then, generate 2 million points, and they will constitute a histogram of the function c times h. Okay? And then we reject the points that stick out. So we're going to sit here and look at this line and say, in this line, I accept all the points below and I reject all the points above. Okay? So let's write this as a unitary algorithm. This is interesting. We say there is an algorithm that generates points x according to px. Now I have to say, what is big px? Well, I do the following. I say, first, I generate point y1 according to the distribution h of y1. H is a distribution. So this is a valid statement. It says here, I have an algorithm that produces h. I use that algorithm. And then I do the following thing. I say, now I generate a random number between 0 and 1. I'm now sitting on this line. Here's y1. I'm sitting on this line. I'm generating a random number, and I compare, what do I compare? I compare the p with c times h. So if c times h of y1 times rho 1 is smaller than p of y1, see that? Then that means I'm sitting here. I'm sitting in the histogram of P. Then I keep that point. Then I say, I accept that point to be X. In the other case, if it happens to be larger, I'm sitting somewhere here. I don't want that point, I just try again. What do you mean by trying again? Well, I mean by generating a y2 according to h of y2, and then generating a number d rho 2, and then performing the same check. And you can see that if I want to write this algorithm out completely, I can't do it because it's infinitely long. And it's true, of course, you can be unlucky. You can maybe try a million times before you finally end up below the curve of P. It's very improbable, but it could happen. And this algorithm is infinitely long, but if you remember the discussion of continued fractions, we can see that we can actually telescope this. Because the part that's here is exactly the same as what we had before. It's just equal to P. And now I can try to calculate what p is. The integral o d rho, where rho 1 is smaller than this number, what is this? It is simply p of y1 over c times h of y1. Yeah? And what I have here is what's the rest of the integral. And the row is gone. This is the joy of working on the blackboard. Okay? Now, what we see now is that if I look at this term here, this term here has a 1 times p multiplied by the integral over y, which is 1. So actually, this 1 cancels against him. So 0 here. He's gone. And then, so. So. Now we see a number of nice things. The H drops out. He drops out and he drops out. And he drops out and he drops out. That's good. The C is a common factor. This also drops out. And then we see that P of X is small P of X divided by the integral dy P of Y. So we have proven now that indeed the big P of X is small p of x, even better. Suppose that small p of x is not properly normalized. This algorithm will prove that it's properly normalized when it comes out, because I have a 1 on the left-hand side. That's why the algorithm is called unitary. Okay? Now this, of course, sounds a bit highbrow just to understand this pictorial picture, but I think it's interesting to see that you have this infinitely long algorithm that you can actually telescope. So you see, this is really different from inversion. Reaction is really different from inversion for several reasons. First, I do not have to know the integral of P. I just have to be able to evaluate P. And this obviously works in any dimension that I like.
Okay.
It has a drawback, of course. I have to be able to find a function H that is not too unreasonable. And I have to be able to know what is the number C. That means I have to know what is the maximum of the value P. And the maximum might actually be infinite. Right? And also, typically, that is not necessarily true, but it is historical. People took for the H always the uniform distribution. Okay? That is perfectly allowed as long as your integration region is finite. But if you integrate from minus to plus infinity, there is no uniform distribution. That means we know what is the maximum of e to the x squared. The maximum of e to the x squared is 1. But we cannot generate e to the minus x squared by rejection because the box is too large. It runs from minus to plus infinity. Okay. So the Gaussian distribution is really a tricky beast. But now we have shortly discussed this, shortly discussed that. These are the two basic strategies. You manipulate random numbers by subjecting them to functions, and you can modify or at least make the final correction to your distribution if you wish by using rejection. Also, in rejection, you have to be careful of things like this. Huh? Suppose my distribution is narrow and it has a very high peak. Okay, and suppose the only thing I know how to do is to generate from the uniform distribution. And you see, you will have to try many, many times before you accept an event. And that's, of course, a disadvantage of rejection, but sometimes a disadvantage you can't do very much about because this function is not well enough known. Okay, but now we come to what the rule of Nifty, which says that if there is, this is my formulation, if there is a clever way to calculate an integral in such a way that you say, hey, that's nifty, then that typically leads to an algorithm. Now, you have all done this. And if you have not done this, you should be ashamed and do it. How do you calculate this integral? What is the standard nifty way of calculating this integral? You square, right? K squared is the double integral over the whole plane, e to the minus x squared minus y squared. And now we go to polar coordinates to say x is r sine phi and y is r cosine phi. And we get 0 to infinity dr to 2 pi d phi r e to the minus r squared. And this is pi times 0 to infinity 2r dr e to the minus r squared. And then I say r is square root of s. And I get pi times 0 to infinity ds e to the minus s. And this is pi. It's the well-known result. You've all seen this derivation or done this derivation, right? And now we say, hey, this is nifty. And what I have here on the right-hand side is almost exactly an algorithm for getting this distribution. The only thing I have to do here is to realize that we have to find an algorithm to generate e to the minus s. But we have that, in fact. And we can say this is where s is minus log t. So how do we generate this important normal distribution? We just work down these lines in the opposite order. So what we say is that, first of all, T is a uniform random number between 0 and 1. Okay? And then S is minus log T. Phi is 2 pi times another uniform random number between 0 and 1. And R is square root of S. And X is R sine phi. And Y is R cosine phi. And here is your algorithm for generating not one, but two normally distributed numbers, because you can see here X and Y are independent, because the probability densities factorize. So I use two random numbers, I mix them together, and I get two independent Gaussian random numbers. This is called the Box-Müller algorithm, after the guys who somewhere in the early 60s or so proposed this algorithm for the first time. Now, you can complain about it. You could say, well, you know, I have to calculate a log, I have to calculate a square root, I have to calculate a sine and a cosine. It all takes time. That is true. Nowadays, that is not so important. Typically, in a serious Monte Carlo calculation, not much of the time is actually spent in getting Gaussian random numbers. Much more of the time is spent in doing other things. If you wish, though, you say, well, I can avoid taking the sine and the cosine by a clever combination of rejection and combining numbers. The following thing, what I do is, let me see, I take X to be 2 times a random number minus 1. So it's an integer between minus 1 and 1. Y is 2 times a random number minus 1, another random number, of course. Every time I call my random number generator, I get a different number. That is why it's called a random number generator. And then I say, if X squared plus Y squared is smaller than 1, then I'm in the unit circle. Then I say that sine phi is 2xy over x squared plus y squared. And cosine phi is x squared minus y squared over x squared plus y squared. So now you don't have to calculate sines and cosines. You have to calculate some squares in a division. If you want to see that this indeed gives you a uniformly distributed phi, go ahead, use your unitary algorithm formalism and prove it. Okay. The other things where the rule of Nifty comes in. One interesting case is, in fact, something that we'll probably not get to in these lectures, but I just want to give you a taste. Suppose I want to generate a distribution of numbers numbers n, which is that tells me all the numbers are positive. X1 is distributed according to an integer k1. X2 goes like x2 to the k2, and xn to the kn. And there's a constraint that all the x's should add up to 1. This is a very tough problem, so to look at it. Even if I forget about these powers here, it's still a tough problem. How do I generate 12 random numbers such that they add up to 1? Well, you could say I generate the first one, and then I generate the second one in the interval that is left, and then the third one. But you see the numbers will all tend to cluster at the end, so that's not the way to do it. In fact, what you do is consider this more democratically. Let me only discuss the simplified case where I leave out the powers. Okay? But what I do first, I say I generate numbers y according to the exponential distribution. We know how to do that. It's a minus logarithm for every y. Okay? Now, these numbers y, they are positive, but they feel no constraint. Okay? And obviously, their sum is not going to be equal to 1. It would be extremely, extremely surprising. So what I do, I calculate the sum, y1 plus yn equal s, okay? And then I simply say I replace y1 by y1 over s and call that x1. And do that for every y, okay? Now you might ask yourself, why the hell would I use the exponential distribution here? Because all the y's, certainly, they could be less than 1 or so. But we'll see in a moment that is actually a very good idea. So, there's one thing that I've been cheating, actually. I can say, well, all these numbers must be positive and they add up to 1, but there is some normalization factor here that I don't know. It's not equal to 1. Okay? So I have to calculate that normalization factor. I'll calculate this normalization factor, and the rule of Nifty tells me, hey, this is a nice way to calculate that, and we can use it to generate points. So how do I do that? I do that by just eliminating the y's from this expression, because I want to keep the x's. I started here with, hey, there is an algorithm to get the y's, it's here, and I want to change it in the algorithm for the x's. So how do I do that? Not so complicated. I multiply inside the delta function. Okay, but then that gives me a power s to the n. Okay, now I can see that where I see a y, I replace it by s times x. That means the x's automatically are larger than 0. And where are the y's sitting? They're sitting here. And they're sitting here. Hey, look at this. This is e to the minus s. This is why I took those exponentials. It only depends on s. So it's e to the minus s. And now I can simply erase the y's. The x's run from 0 to infinity. And the delta functions are gone. Yes, and then I see that here, I can take out an s and see that I get the correct delta function that I want, okay? And then now the only thing left is to do the integral over s. So I find dx1 to dxn delta for the sum to be 1 times n minus 1 factorial. This is the way of calculating the normalization, or in fact, to calculate this integral, and you get 1 over n factorial, n minus 1 factorial. If I would have powers of x, say x1 to the k1, then I would simply generate y1 to the k1 e to the minus y1. And that would give me Euler's formula. Okay? But now I see what is now the algorithm to generate this Euler density, as we call it, because it leads to Euler's formula. It's very simple. I take yj, or yn, yk, from minus log of a random number k. For k is 1 to n. And then I calculate s is the sum of the y's, and then xk is simply yk divided by s for all k. Okay. So this is a very simple simple way of getting this distribution that otherwise would be almost impossible. Now, why am I happy with this distribution? Because I will just say it in words, I will not spend too much time on it. If I want to do particle physics, one of the big problems is to generate particle momenta inside the allowed physical phase space. In a scattering experiment, particles are produced, sometimes many particles. They fly in all directions, and I want to integrate over all the possible structures of the events, that is, all the possible energy and momenta of the particles, taking into account the restrictions of momentum and energy conservation, and the fact that the particles have to be on the mass shell. This object called phase space is extremely important, but also extremely non-linear object. And it has been, for decennia, a big problem of how to impose the constraints of energy momentum conservation on the momenta. And this is a constraint like this, right? It's a four-dimensional constraint, sure. But if you know how to do this, you know how to do it in four dimensions, because what you then do, and especially for massless particles, you generate particle momenta that don't know about each other with some exponential cutoff for the energy. Okay, we can do that. And then I take the whole set of momenta, I calculate the total momentum, I perform a Lorentz boost on all the momenta that bring me to the common center of mass frame, and then I perform a scaling on all the momenta such that the total energy is correct. Then I know that I have massless particle momenta that satisfy energy and momentum constraint. And the surprising and nice thing is, if you do that correctly, you can prove that, similarly to here, that the density that you generate in that way is uniform. This is the so-called Rambo algorithm. You're not in the business of generating phase space points, but if you are in the business of generating phase space points, you will know this Rambo algorithm that I'm very proud of, because I wrote it. Okay, but this is too technical. I'm not going to discuss that. But what I want to discuss, multi-channeling, I leave that maybe. There will be some in the final version of the lecture notes. But let's discuss random walks. It's also another interesting and relevant thing. But it's a little bit different from things like inversion and rejection. Inversion, rejection, rule of Nifty, what they aim at, that you use random points that are independent and identically distributed, and you get other random points out, non-uniform, but identically distributed and independent. Now, suppose you relax those conditions a little bit, say, well, I don't necessarily have my points to be independent, but it could be effectively independent. And what you then consider is that your point moves through the allowed space, the space where your distribution is sitting, like a random walk, in such a way that the distribution of the points that it visits is the probability distribution that you want. Okay? And, well, that is a good strategy, and there are various ways of doing that. But then, of course, if your point performs a random walk, you should realize that the various points are not independent of one another. Okay? It depends on your calculation, on your problem, whether that is a problem or not such a big problem. Okay, let's first discuss the most well-known of them. The Metropolis algorithm. It looks deceptively simple. The point is the following. I've been generating and moving through my space. At a certain moment, I am at a point xn. Okay, the space could be a hypercube, could be a real line, whatever you want. This is a space in which my probability density lives, can be more dimensional, never mind. Now what I do is, I sit at x1. Then I have a, a stepping function. It's not a step function. There's a function g that depends on the point where you are. And it picks for you a candidate new point with a probability density g that depends on xn and z. Okay. What this probability density is, in principle, completely free. How you step from one point to a candidate new point is up to you. The only thing that is extremely important is that it should be symmetric. So if you are at xn, the chances to go to z is exactly the same as, suppose you are at z, the chances to go to xn. And this is called detailed balance. And any application of the Metropolis algorithm then has to satisfy this detailed balance condition. But okay, for the rest, g is a probability density that you can think of yourself. Okay, now. So we have generated, we generate a new possible z. Okay, then we look at the probability density. It could be that the probability of this candidate new point is higher than the probability where you are at this moment. That's good, high probability. You want to go there often. Yeah. So I accept Z as my new point. Now, on the other hand, it is possible that your new probability is lower. And you could say, ah, okay, let's try again for a new point. Maybe probability is higher. But what you're doing then is, then you're not generating P of X. You're just trying to walk towards a maximum of P of X. It's not the same thing. No. You can say, no, even if the probability goes down, I'm still allowed to accept it, but with a chance, with probability P of Z over P of Xn. So I calculate this probability. If it's a number but smaller than zero, then I will accept a new point with that probability. Okay? And if not, I do not move to a new point. I simply stay where I am. Okay? You see, this extremely simple algorithm. You can remark a few things about it. I will prove in a moment that it works. But we can remark things about it. If you stay at a point where you already are, that means you have the same point in your distribution twice. And that looks a bit clumsy. So typically what people do is, this is one step in the Metropolis algorithm. You do this a few times, or maybe many times, yes? Oh, this is computer lingo. It means I have a number z, and I call it x to n plus 1. Okay. If you feel more comfortable with an equal sign.
It would be okay if we put an equal sign, right? I mean,
yes, okay. Yes. In pseudocode, which is actually also in the lecture notes, you preferably take this assignment sign, because an equal sign could also mean that you test if these things are equal. And this is just the definition of a new variable, so it's a little bit. But if you feel more comfortable with an equal sign, just read an equal sign. Okay. So you do not want to see the same point x and repeat it all over again. So typically what you do, you make sure that, that's the rule of thumb, your g should be such that you accept the new points in about half of the cases. Okay. And then if you step like 10 times and then look where you are, then the chances are very small that you are still at the old point. Now that's if you have a random walk, but you take a sufficient number of steps, then the points with many steps in between, they are kind of independent. Yes? Well, as I said, if I reject and I try again, then I am only moving if my probability increases. Okay? So then I will be looking for the maximum of the probability distribution. Let's see the probability distribution as a mountain landscape. If I just only move upwards, I will end up at a mountaintop. And I will not move down from the mountaintop. So then, in the end, my probability distribution that I generate will be a delta function. And that's not the thing I want. I want to be I want to be able to visit all places in this mountain landscape. That means occasionally I have to step down. And it's also not unreasonable. Suppose that these probabilities are almost equal. Then you say, hey, why not take this little step backward and go to some new place? But let's try and prove that this algorithm actually is good. So, one of these things that I have never seen in any text, but it's interesting to do it. So, suppose that I change my point of view a little bit, and I take not one random walker, but I take lots and lots of random walkers, okay? And they are, in the beginning, they are, say, uniformly distributed over my hypercube. And then I say, go, and all these random walkers, they make one step of this algorithm. So they look for a new point. Shall I go there, or maybe I stay here? So after this one step, the distribution of all these random walkers is no longer what it was, because, well, depending on where they are, this guy may have stepped, that guy has stayed where he was, the distribution is changed. So I start with a distribution p zero of my points. That's the probability for a random walker to be in position x at time zero. And then it evolves into a distribution after one step, which evolves in a distribution after two steps. And so it continues. And at a certain moment, after n steps, I look at the distribution of my thousands of walkers and I see that makes some mountain landscape. Okay. Now, shall I describe the working of the algorithm using the language of unitary algorithms, which tells that what is the distribution after yet another step? Well, I had an algorithm to generate the distribution p of step one. After all, that is what I did. I have these numbers. So then I say, I generate dz g of y and z. That is I use the stepping function. And then I say, if p of z is larger than p of y, so I increase in probability. This is not the pn, this is the target distribution, as we call it. And I say, okay, x is equal to y. Okay, let me write another line. I do the same with my y, I do the same with my g of my z, but now I have the case that p of z is smaller than p of y, okay, then I may still accept the new point, but with a certain probability, which is then simply p z over p of y, x minus y. So here I accept anyway because I step up in probability. Here I accept conditionally, I maybe accept, and then there's the case where I do not accept, and that has a probability of 1 minus this, which I write in two lines. Theta, p of z smaller than p of y. Delta, let's see, x minus z. I wrote x minus y here, which means you stay where you are. You won't want to move to the new place. Okay? And then minus d of y, pn of y. And I generate z again. And I look for the case where p pz smaller than py, and the probability to stay where you are is 1 minus this guy. So here I have a pz over py delta x minus y. That's a whole lot of writing. Okay. Now, what I want to prove, or to argue at least, that the target density, the p, is a fixed point of this algorithm. Okay. So what I will now try to prove is that suppose that Pn of y is actually P of y itself. What happens? What happens for Pn plus 1? Okay. Well, if Pn of y is Py, then I can simplify this a bit. I can have this. Okay. And here, this P of y cancels against him. This is P of y. Okay. So, now look at these lines, the first and the fourth line. And now realize that there is detailed balance, so I may interchange it. Then these two lines are the same. I can rename z and y, and they cancel against each other. So, it goes away, this goes away. And look at the second and the third line, and realize that I have y and z. Here's detailed balance, I can interchange this, then I relabel. So, and this is y, and this is y, okay? Then this boils down to P of x, because this is where the one is larger than the other, and the other is the other case. Okay, so if I happen to have hit the target distribution, I stay there. Okay. So that's a very nice and simple algorithm, and it is of course simple in that sense that you only have to calculate the p's. Okay. Now there are various applications possible, and the one that is very widely used, especially in statistical physics, is the one where you have a particular probability distribution and you do a statistical physics simulation, or you do statistical physics. You typically have a state, a space of possible states of a system, and the probability for each state to occur will be something like e to the minus 1 over kt of, say, the Hamiltonian that depends on x. X may, for instance, be a collection of spins, up and down spins, with interaction between them, okay? And then you have the Ising model. Now, even in two dimensions, if I have Ising, hypercubic lattice of spins that can up and down, there's 10,000 spins involved, that's a lot, okay? And even to calculate the energy of a system of 10,000 spins is not a simple matter. And what I want to do is I want to compute thermodynamic quantities that are actually averages over this probability density. So I want to sample this probability density. Now, notice now that if I have in my Metropolis step, I have to calculate the ratio of probabilities, which tells me this is e to the minus 1 over kt times the difference in energies. I see. That is nice, because if my steps, I can be anything, but if my steps are, for instance, the flipping of one spin from up to down, okay, and I have, say, nearest neighbor interactions, then I only have to see what this spin does with its nearest neighbors, and that is a trivial calculation. Okay, so therefore, this Metropolis algorithm, it fits very nicely just because it's an exponential probability distribution. In fact, it fits so nicely that people say that you have to look for e to the minus probability or so. It's a misunderstanding. The Metropolis algorithm works for ratios of probabilities, but that tends to be differences in energy for these statistical systems. Okay. Now, of course, you don't want, for instance, in the Ising model, you do not want to have only single spin flips. Why is that? Well, because if you are at high temperature, T is high, this KT is large, this exponential is essentially always one, so you just wander around, spins go up and down, and it becomes random. If the temperature is lowered, then the differences in energy, if you step down in energy, is punished more severely, so spins tend to align. What that means is that at sufficiently low energy, your space will get regions with spin up and other regions with spin down. Okay? Of course, we know at the end of the day, at zero temperature, you expect for a ferromagnet, at least all the spins, to be equally aligned. But how to go from, say, how to switch this thing here from up to down by flipping individual spins, fighting against the punishment in energy time and time again. This will take much, much longer than the lifetime of the universe. Okay? So another step, and that's the nice thing about the Metropolis algorithm, you can decide not to flip just one spin, but take a whole block and flip that. And you're completely free to do that. You don't have to use the same G all the time. You can change it at will. Or you can say, well, the first 10 million iterations, I will not use flipping of blocks, but after that, I will start using. It's completely free, as long as detailed balance is conserved, is preserved. Okay? So there's, of course, a whole industry with rules of thumb and nice methods of people who do these lattice calculations. And I don't know enough about it to go into that. There's another application, which is also nice, which I think will be the last thing I tell you. And this is the traveling salesman problem, or related problems. Who does not know what is the traveling salesman problem? Okay, it's a simple enough, explained simply enough. So you are a traveling salesman, and here are a number of cities with known distances between them, and then you have to visit all those cities in any order you like, but of course you want to do it as cheaply as possible, so the total distance must be as short as possible, okay? So you do not want to do this. This would be a very inefficient way of doing it, because you spend a lot of time traveling between distant cities. So you want to travel to nearby cities, but you want to visit them all. Now, if I have n cities, and if I say I don't care where I start, I want to come back there, and I don't care which direction I traverse my collection of cities, there's n minus 1 factorial over 2 possible permutations. Okay? And typically n is like 100 or so. If n is 10, 11, 12, then you can just make a list of all the permutations and say, look it up and say, hey, this is the shortest way. But if you have to visit 100 cities, the number of permutations is just impossibly large. So what do you do then? You do your Metropolis algorithm. For every permutation, which I call P, the total trajectory has a length L of P. Okay. Which I can calculate, because I know the distance between all these cities. And now I do Metropolis by using a probability. The probability for this particular permutation is e to the minus 1 over kt L of p. Now, k is, of course, not Boltzmann constant, but kt is something, some tunable parameter. Okay? So what I will do is I start by walking through the space of permutations with my Metropolis algorithm at fairly high temperature. So all these permutations are kind of equally probable. And then I gradually lower the temperature. So T goes to zero slowly. That's why this is called simulated annealing, because that's what you do if you want to make a nice piece of metal.
Okay.
So you lower the temperature slowly, and it means that larger trajectory, longer trajectories get a little bit more severely punished, so you tend to stay away from that. And at the moment that T becomes really small, then only the trajectories with very short lengths will actually be possible. Okay? And you hope that your system freezes in maybe not the absolute minimum length, but one of the minima that it is a very good short length. This works surprisingly well. And the one condition, of course, what would, yes?
Do you have only one sieve or many?
What, one?
One walker.
No, well, yes. Look, it depends. If you program in parallel, you get many walkers, but.
No, I mean, if, for example, if you have many and they wouldn't like to be in the same state at the same time.
Oh, yes, okay, you can make this very difficult, yes. The remark is, but maybe there are two salesmen and they hate each other. They don't want to be in the same city. Yes, this is difficult enough as it is already. Normally, what you would do if you have this collection of cities, so. As you do it differently. So. So, here I have eight cities, a simple problem. And at some stage, this is my optimal trajectory. Okay? How do I get here? I get here by taking the list of cities and then just permuting cities pairwise. That's the obvious step to do. It's like flipping one spin. Okay? Now, here, I have a disk trajectory, and now it's the triangle law tells me that this is never optimal when these guys cross. Okay? You would like them to uncross. But if he goes up, then he goes up as well. Yeah? So if I somehow make a flip, some step in my Metropolis algorithm to end up with this, then he has to go down. So this is surprisingly what you can do with the traveling salesman problem, which is very popular with my students. If I give them assignments for a grade for a course in Monte Carlo, many of them want to do the traveling salesman problem. And then they say, well, you take permutation of cities, and occasionally you take a block of cities, and you reverse it. And that gets rid of that problem, and you get beautiful pictures. One student told me, ever since I was a little boy, I always wanted to know the shortest way to visit all the provincial capitals of Bangladesh or so. And then he managed, yes.
I have a feeling that this algorithm, you start with a point, then take the shortest possible city. Then that guy also calculates what is the shortest and probability. Then they can stack in the two cities.
Yes, you mean if two cities are very close together, you would prefer them to stay close together. Yes, that is true, but there might be situations where it is better to sever that step between these two cities because it gains you a very large, it gains you very much in some other place. I can probably draw sets of points for you when we say, yes, it's better, even if the cities are close together, not to go from one to the other. But again, every step that you want to take is fine, provided detailed balance is preserved. Okay, now a few of the time, I'll leave it with this. I've tried to give you an overview of Monte Carlo and also some of the mathematics behind it. I hope you enjoyed it, and if you ever see a random number in the rest of your career, think of me. Thank you. All right. Now it's time for the coffee break. And after the break, we will come back here and discuss my exercises.